then we get procedures, and we have to manage each other, and by the class, like, questions.
Okay, so... So the next database I was going to talk about is called PDB.
So PDB is
protein databank. So that's the database of all protein structures. And in this course we'll use it quite a lot. And it's also a typical example of an old traditional database. It actually has a file format that is, we see it here, but that is, I can actually show you. That is really, really old fashioned. So if you go to pdb.org, and it has a very nice front end web page for people to use, but it's has a very, very, an underlying part is very much an old type of database structure. So it has a file format that people at least tried 10 times to change, but always failed.
Didn't they change it like 3 months ago?
They did it every 3 months ago, yes, sure. So, so this is the latest entry. This critical structure of the human something, SMPC6485. So this is obviously, and there are also final names, like a number and then 4 letters. So that's, I guess it's still can have it. So this is some kind of a nice picture of this one. We can have some different views of it. And you can look at it. So it's a nice web page. But if you want to, for instance, just had a PDB file, it looks like that. And it looked like that for this old, since it almost had paper codes reading the data. So it has a very much format. It has, every line has a keyword and then some data. So this is a header and the title, some compounds we actually have there. It has a paper and journal where it's published. It has some remarks, can be whatever you want, or more or less, and then it has some. A lot of remarks, this one. And then it has some other references, database references. And then you have some sequence information. This one is some strangely something engineered mutations here, a lot of mutations. And then you have the sequence here. And this one actually has an A chain, and a C chain, and a B chain. And the G strain, and then lot of different shapes. It seems like to be the same protein. These look very similar to me. Lots of copy them. And then it has some annotation about the structure. And then it has atoms. Basically, it has one line saying that atom 1 is a nitrogen from glutamic acid in chain A. Residues 367, and it has these coordinates in XYZ, and it has its occupancy 1, and the B factor of 4.35, and it's a type M. And it's really, see, everything is straight lines, everything like that. But it, unfortunately, there are some exceptions, so there are some things that not always happens. Sometimes it happens if this number is more than, less than minus 9999, what you do then, and so on. So it's also a pretty nice computer readable format in all ways. It's nice to look at it like that. But it's really quite a bad format, but every single program that reads PDB files handles it in own way. And there's always some strange exception that you need to avoid. But it's nice, you basically have everything, every protein here, and the front end nowadays is quite nice actually. You have a lot of information about the structure. A lot of cross links to other databases and a lot of other data. So that's, and of course, what people do, like me, is that we download all. PDB is in the order of 100,000 files, so it's much smaller than database. So it's not, it's something you can actually handle yourself quite easily. This is something that, and then there are also a lot of secondary databases. One of my favorite ones is called PFAM.
It was developed by
Erik Sonhammar, who gives the course at comparative genomics. He did it during his PhD, so it was a long time ago, and then it's mainly maintained by people in England, DBI. So it has a definition of protein families, actually protein domain families, you know, tell them what talk more about later. So basically it has, at least what is nice is that it tells you what all proteins that belong to the same family do, and how they are common together. And it has a good way of searching it. And particularly what is useful with it is it's actually rather easy to maintain. People have done, so basically what you want to find is proteins that are similar in sequence to each other. And earlier programs had, you did that, you took all the sequences and you compared them all to each other, and then you tried to find whatever is similar. The problem was that every time you get new sequences, you get slightly different results. So PFAM has a smart way of dealing with that, so it's really, it's mostly maintained from release to release. So there are certain new sequences, but the basic family definitions does not change. Except if something wrong in it, of course, you can change it, but otherwise it doesn't change. So this is actually a database we'll talk about more in one lecture later. Another type of databases that are kind of related are also similar. They take the structure of databases and process them into domains, they cluster them together. There are at least three ones that are there. One is CAS, another one is SCOP, and another one is ECOD. These have had the problem of typical problem in the database. They have probably got funding to be maintained. Because they also need a bit of manual requirements, but particularly SCOP was basically one person who did that, and here is maybe a small group of people, but they really have difficult to get the funding for it. But it's there's one new one that is called ECOD that is actually supposed to be up to date. The other ones are a bit old. So this is basically you have protein sequences, protein structures, and you have secondary databases like SCOP, CAF, or PFAM. And often it's more useful to look in the secondary databases if you want to know what a protein is doing. There's also a lot of databases of functional classification of proteins that are. Some of them are specific to an organism, so for the fly database and the yeast database and then the E. coli database, etc. There are enzyme classifications that are part of a CISPOT. There are COG is the NCBA version of it. So there are a lot of things that are classified together. There are. I was talking about my lady. You know, function is a difficult definition in protein. How do you describe function of a protein? You can say this is a translocase, this is a transporter. You can describe the n steps are not that hard, but functions can be divided into many different ways, and it's often it can be a cancer gene. How do you find out? Is it cancer? What is this function then? What is it doing? So there is an attempt to classify how you classify functions. This is what I call an ontology. So it's a gene ontology. So this has three main functions. One is a molecular function. So you can have, for instance, you can be an enzyme. If you have an enzyme, it can, for instance, be a helicase. If it's a helicase, it can be a DNA helicase or ATP-dependent helicase. And so ATP-dependent helicases. It can also be acted as an adenosine triphosphatase, which still means it can be a helicase or another triphosphatase. It can also be nuclear binding, nucleic acid binding, or DNA binding, and of course, helicase can be binding. So it's kind of a tree or like a mesh-like structure that can describe the functions. So every DNA function you can somehow define as a molecular function, and every function is a protein you can define this function. So it's not a perfect way, but it somehow describes the complexity of biology also. But you can also have, like, for instance, you can have also what's called metabolic process. What is actually what is the biological process doing? So this an enzyme that does the helicase. That's the enzyme, but you don't know what it does in the cell because it's a helicase. But it can be involved in DNA degradation or DNA replication. In the case, maybe it's DNA dependent replication. And then it can be born in priming, initiation, or unwinding. So it can do a lot of different things, but actually, enzymatically, it's the same thing. So this is a completely different process. You have a metabolic process. And also it can be in different cellular components. It can be in the cytoplasm, in the nucleus, or in the mitochondria, or in the virus, etc. So it can be very active. So you need to have all these three different levels to describe some of the function of a protein. This was the old way of classifying things in enzymes just, and this is genome annotation things. So in general, you can get some kind of GU annotation of if you find one of these databases. So you have genome ontology, and then one browser that is Amigo. Well. So the classical pre-processing, earlier there was a lot of focus on enzyme classification. This being from the 70s, I think, a database or way to classify enzyme functions, and it's an easy classification. It's not always perfect because there are overlap here, but you have like oxidoreductases, transferases, hydrolases, isomerases, ligases. And then you see you have the number. The first number figure actually what it's doing, what the reaction is doing. Second one is describes the substrate or the group that's transferred on that. And third, the type of acceptor. And then four is more specific. And so you have, for instance, 1.14.17.3 is peptidyl alpha mediating enzyme hydroxylase. Alpha medium monooxygenase. So in this case, catalytic activity, isomerase, intermolecular isomerases, they are doing it in the same molecule. And then something that changes the CC bond is 533X. And you can go on. Okay, so that's back to proteins. And then another big set of databases is actually really good to genomes. So the standard for eukaryotic genomes nowadays is a database, also English one or British one. It's called Ensemble or UPN, but it's many people actually have an annotation of many of the eukaryotic genomes. So if you go to Ensemble. So this is like a way to, if you really want to find something, so it has a lot of for example, human, mouse, and zebrafish, a lot of them. I think they have, this is all the species they have. So it's basically all the animals. Don't think there are any, so basically all animals. So you can think the human genome. Look at assembly. So you can get some statistics. If they have now, this is December 2013 Homo sapiens high coverage assembly from this consortium is 3.4 billion bases long. There's more information about it. This is gene annotation. So you have automatic annotation pipeline that is incorporating new protein DNA, cDNA sequences which have been publicly available since 38, etc. And it has like a comparison with Neanderthal browser. Here you have this 3.5 billion base pairs long, it's the golden deposit, 3.1, something like that. It has 20,330 genes and 25,180 non-coding genes. That's basically RNA. 14,007 genes, 20,000 different transcripts, that's different spike forms, 2,400 alternative splicing, etc. And you can basically, if you go into you can search for BRCA2, find a famous breast cancer gene. See if you find a human gene here. This is here. You can look in the genome where it is. You can see where it is. And this is like eight different exons coding for different parts of it. And this is the protein coding where this is some other transcripts, not the coding. There seems to be two different coding transcripts here. I don't know exactly where they differ. But somewhere. And so if you can click, you can probably click there and you get some more information about it. You can raise it, you want to look at variations, you can probably find it somewhere. Yeah, click on the gene. So you need to zoom into the genome and look exactly how it looks like, what is annotated, what is the information for it, and so on, for every single gene in all these organisms. And of course, you can download it and get to it. So here is, you can zoom in the region here much more carefully. If you want to zoom, I guess you'll do it. Then we'll have one up and down, see what other genes are next to it. Click on one gene here. And this is a merged gene association here, some other, this has different things here. You have an RNA gene, you have cell genes, etc, etc.
So, Ensemble is probably the place, well, it's one of the places where you really have good annotation of the human genome and of most animal genomes. So that is, and then there is also another thing that is important for this expression database. There are, of course, databases of where protein genes are expressed. So basically, you do an RNA-seq. And this is certainly out of date, but this is old databases. This come database called Gene Express and Gene Expression. And for protein expression, there was a database called TRIDE. So both all these contain tons of experiments and a lot of data and information, but this is most of it is processed data, so it's you have to check actually how it was processed. There's also databases about interactions, so about protein interactions. So how what proteins are into or molecular interactions? So you have, so somehow you have you're trying to get map that goes to that, so you're saying that protein A is interacting with B. You can look at these nice networks, and you have different ways with pathways. But it, in principle, you start off with, this is something that is not standard database. There are databases, and most of them are somehow using either collection of data that is known, so basically reading papers, or automatically reading papers, or predicting interactions from different types of experiments. There are quite few that are direct data-direct interactions. There are, of course, for instance, for protein structures, you have a lot of data, of course. You know that if you have two proteins in the same structure next to each other, you know they interact. And there are lots of other experiments, but they're not really well collected in a nice database. But the goal is always to get something like this, that you have nice. But one of the good places is actually String. String is a good database for this. So here you can just go to String and you String DB String DB dot And if you type bracket 2, it is a mouse, right? The mouse, okay. I can find the Mac bracket 2 breast cancer gene mouse somewhere here, and it's interacting with bracket 1. And the nice thing here is that you can actually see here. How do you know these two proteins interact? For these genes in this case. And then different experiments. So there are some homology things, there are some text mining, so you find text mining, you have some database that contains it, some experimental data for it.
another type of experimental data, and there are some genome data you can use for it. And then you have a score here, which is basically between 0 and 1, depending on how likely it is. And it's 0.9999, so it's very likely to interact. And you can look here in the neighborhood around this. You can click another one and you look at the protein that was there. So you see that has a set of proteins here that interact together.
And often you think the proteins that interact together are somehow functional couples. So it can be quite nice to know that, okay, I know this protein is involved in this disease. Are there any other potential diseases, proteins that can be involved in the same disease? Or I don't know what my protein is doing, but what is interacting with? It's interacting with other proteins, and if I know something about them, I might be able to tell something about my protein myself. So the string entry has something like that, and it is a nice layout. In this case, there's another example that you have some proteins with high scores. So there are also old databases or reactions and pathways. So like you have databases that actually tells, if you remember from biochemistry, you have this flow chart, you have the Krebs cycle and everything like that. Of course, this is also come out data that's there. And if you know your reaction pathways, there are databases for that, so you can map your proteins onto these. Some of them are listed here. So there are ways to find this. Of course, NCBI is a good place to find things, or EBI also. There used to be methods called SRS and XPAC and so on that are try to integrate these things together, but it's nothing that really taken over the whole world. It really is people do what they want and you search around, but often NCBI has very good tools and EBI, they kind of do. I'm sure the Japanese also have good tools, but I don't use them. So once upon a time, actually, got to your databases like that, in CD or DVD, not any longer. So, but in NCBI, you can search databases. So in NCBI, you can do searching in different ways and putting together, use Boolean expressions, etc. And you have accession numbers, you find things, etc. Things like that. So it's kind of. And you can do searches with Swissprot and PubMed, etc. Like most of these works quite well, but it's a bit of a trial and testing. So what should you think about when you find a database on the web, or if you're using? The key thing is really, what is the data coming from? What is it doing? So what is, how is the data entered? Is it really someone has curated it? Is it just automatic? Is it some way of some predictions? Is it processed in some way? Because really, whatever is there might matter what you do with it later. So if you want to look for all the proteins in an organism, so you can just download them as proteins, but they are not most likely actually studied. The data is not entered as proteins. They entered the genomic data, and then someone has made a prediction of what the coding regions are, and someone has made the protein predictions. But in each of these steps, there is a you need to take into account some parameters. You need to make cutoffs. So for instance, if finding a very short protein is difficult in an automatic pipeline because you can't separate it from the background. So you might miss small proteins. On the other hand, small proteins are more likely to be falsely predicted for positive losses. So there's always a balance there. And you can probably improve it by using other data from other genomes, etc., and comparing things. You can do more things. So it really is kind of important to think about how much you trust the data. And even in Swissprot, even the best data there are certainly 1 or 2% that are of the data that is wrong. Somehow, someone has put the data from a paper, and the interpretation is wrong. Experiment was wrong. There's always a significant risk of something wrong. So, it's a pretty good problem nowadays if you want to compare proteins is just that is because proteins come from genomes, from genes, is that often they can be too short because it's just that part of the sequence was not read perfectly,
or an X one is missed, the annotations, and that's common. Well, probably can be other way around, X to X ones also. So the data quality is a key thing. But also for there are another key important thing, particularly in Uniprot in these databases, is that actually there is annotation where the data comes from. So is it really from an experiment? Is it from prediction? Often most of the data comes from what's called inferred by homologies. Basically, someone has done an experiment on one protein, in maybe a mouse, and then you infer it that the human protein does the same thing. Of course, in most cases that's correct, but there are cases where it's not. Or it can be two mouse proteins that are very similar but do different things. So, and also, another common problem, particularly in secondary databases, is that they are not up to date. They're often a bit old. Because basically, people do not have the resources to maintain and update them. There are, of course, not all data is always available, but the patent data, things like that are not available. But in general, I guess, in compared to many other fields, the data is rather open. There is a tradition in bioinformatics, more than in some other fields, that to make data available and to make also programs available. But it's not always the case. There also, of course, is that question that I said, is like someone said here that it was actually the number of entries into these three genome databases are different. So I would guess that they somehow filter redundancy differently. So this probably is there somewhere in behind the pipeline and everything, but that they are, if two entries are identical, some databases show them, some other databases do not show them, or if they are almost identical, you put in some kind of, or if there's two sequences, one is a sub-sequence of the other one, to show there's two entries, one entry. So that's how these things are done, change numbers quite a lot. They're probably not maybe important exactly what is there, but they are. Really, if you want to count things, they do big changes. Okay, so any other questions about databases? So you know how number 15 is tomorrow? Or mm-hmm. You can ask questions about to repeat all of this? Or freedom might choose another number? Not 17, you can't do that.